All right, good morning, everyone. All right, I'm going to give this a try today. One or two things are going to happen. I'm going to cough to death at the end, or I might sound like a dying cat while we're singing, but I guess we'll see how it goes. All right, page 318, I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. There are things as we travel this earth-shifting sands that transcend all the reason of man. But the things that matter the most in this world, they can never be held in our hand. I believe a hill called Mount Calvary. I believe whatever the cause, and when time has surrendered and earth is no more, I'll still cling to that old rugged cross. I believe Christ, who was slain on that cross, has the power to change lives today. For he changed me completely, a new life is mine. That is why by the cross I will stay. I believe in a hill called week. It was a great time, and we want to thank you for the souls we saw saved, and we just hope that some people those that are saved, that got rejuvenated in their Christian faith, Lord. We just ask that you'd be at the service today, be at the pastors who preaches, and we ask that you'd be at the kids' service upstairs, that the kids would listen, and be at the teacher there as well. And we ask this in Jesus' name, amen. Page 319, Near the Cross. Near the Cross. Jesus, keep me near the cross. There, a precious fountain, free to all, a healing stream flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near
Morning, everybody. Okay. I don't know about you, but he sounded great. And it didn't sound like no drowning cat to me. He did a good job. Good job, Lacey. Today we're going to Psalms 4 through 6. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in judgment of sin, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Amen.
Good morning. Just a few announcements. First of all, events that we announce on Sunday are usually on Facebook. I've been a little lack there, so I'm sorry, but I'll be getting back on that. If you are a Facebook user, check in and let people know we're here. And just typical reminders going on in the church during the week, Wednesday night equip services at 7, of course, 10 a.m. Sunday before this worship service. And Amber, how many weeks do you have left for yours? Are you in week 3 today?
We started 1 today.
Okay. Okay, and it's 6 weeks, right? Okay, so ladies, there's Kingdom Woman is the title of it, and Amber Mitchell is leading that. So it sounds like they're getting started, and that'll be about 6 weeks long. Sometimes that even gets extended. I mean, you know, one lesson can turn into 2 or 3. Right. Okay. So security team, things coming up. Security team, Tom is here. So if you have questions or need anything, you can ask him. But they are meeting at Mad River Armory in Springfield, 4 p.m. next Saturday. So bring your own everything you need or ask Tom how to get it. I cannot answer those questions. Even though he talks about it all the time, I just don't listen. No, I'm just kidding. I do listen. And we have our special Easter service, followed by our biggest Easter egg hunt ever on April 17th. So invite friends, family, and neighbors to that. And then if you have things to share with Tim on Sunday, Sunday is the day to do that for our 90-day challenge for our keeping track of our prayers. So we're praying and telling people that we're praying for them. And just a side note, I appreciate all those that you have sent to us over the last month or so. So that's been great. And keep track of those and turn those numbers into Tim. And we hopefully or may already have, I'm not sure, reached our goal of 1,101 prayers. Not just your prayers, but who are you sharing those with and letting them know that you're praying for them. So I'm sure you're praying way more than 1,101 times as a church over a 3-month period. But we're keeping track of who are we? Excuse me, who are we letting know and sharing that with through a text or a phone call and things like that. So that's all.
Good morning, Revive. So glad to be here with you good people this morning. What a wonderful week we enjoyed and shared together in fellowship. The revival was just awesome. Brother Kent did just a wonderful job. I'm looking forward to it next year. Let's go to the Lord in prayer for the offering. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, for this opportunity to gather here in fellowship and worship you, Father, and sing and praise your holy name, Lord. And we ask your blessing upon this offering, and we ask for discernment for our pastor, deacon, treasurer. They use the funds to further your kingdom. Well, we thank you, Father God, for the Holy Spirit working and bringing four people to accept Christ as our Lord and Savior this week. Through the efforts of our evangelist, Kent York. And we just thank you for that, Lord. And We praise you and love you and just thank you for Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
They talk about my past, my failures, my flaws. They talk about the competition, about willpower and determination. They talk about style, about class. They talk about the big moments, about the prize, about winning. They talk, but I run.
Good morning. I'm not on. Good morning. There I'm on. Welcome. You know, last we I gotta hand it to these folks. We worked pretty hard for the revival. A lot of music. And I told Anthony one night during the revival. I looked at him and I said, "Oh, by the way, the worship team is taking next Sunday off." And I started to walk away, and he had that look on his face like, is he serious? He asked me, well, what are we going to do? I said, I don't care. So, but anyway, here we are, and we love what we do up here. We love worshiping with you folks. So let's stand and continue our worship this morning. By the way, if we sound better, it's because we have a new sound system. And Luke is back there with his apprentice, Levi, and they're going to be, they've got us going here today, so.
Come let us worship our King. Come let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. The hero of heaven, look up and around, and say, oh, thank God to open the chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your favor, oh, thank you, God. You free.
every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We bless in your name, oh God, and we're alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You have done great things, oh God. You do great things.
Tower. Well, amen. Thank you, praise team. You may be seated. Good morning. How's everyone doing this morning? That's what I like to hear. Doing good. Turn your Bibles this morning to Hebrews chapter 5, verse 11. With the revival, I thought we had a great time. It was very exciting, our attendance. I was pleasantly surprised. We started out, I believe, around 56, and then we went up every single night. And by Wednesday, we hit 68 people who were at the revival. Amen? Amen? That's exciting. I hope that you enjoyed Brother Kent. He's kind of hard to describe. I don't know how you describe him, you know. But he did a phenomenal job preaching. I really enjoyed it. I saw people making decisions for the Lord, and we saw people getting saved, and that's what it's all about. Amen? Yeah. And I do want to thank all the ladies that brought food and made the great food we had. I really, really enjoyed that. Amen? And I enjoyed the leftovers the next day. That's one of the best things about being a pastor and working at the church is the next day you sneak down the refrigerator and there's all kinds of ice cream in there and desserts and cake and just a good time. And so I'm thankful for that. I do want to talk to you before I really get into the sermon today. Most of the revival, I spent it in the nursery. And I can't tell you how many times I had to say to a kid, get your finger out of your nose. I don't know how many times I said that, but it was a lot. And I was getting wore out by saying it. But, you know, I tell you, we're very blessed. There are some sweet kids. All the kids were so sweet. I thought they behaved so well and just did a great thing. So, but kids are dismissed. Did I forget that? Yeah. Jacob?
Hey, I just want to say thank you for taking that time in the nursery.
Oh. Well, thank you. Thank you.
And I want to thank you, Sue, for it because wearing Noah out, he felt so thank you.
Hey, I'll be honest with you. It was a stress reliever for me because all the boys wanted to do was run around and see if I could hit them with a ball. So I had a blast. I had a great time. And but, you know, those kids, very sweet and very important. And it made me think about a few things. You know, my kids are older now. Lydia April, she'll be 14. Liam has already turned 12. And so it's been a long time since I've had very little kids. And it reminded me of the importance of when, you know, when you have little kids and you show up to a restaurant and the server walks up and they roll their eyes and they're like, oh, great. Oh, great. Little toddler kids at my table. It's the last thing they want. You know how that makes you feel? It makes you feel like, great. They're miserable. Now I'm miserable. And it's just not a good thing. And it also reminded me of that when I would show up with Lydia and Liam and Lacey and I, we would go out to eat. And you get a good server. They have a big smile on their face. And they're kind to you. But then they also talk to your kids. They talk to your kids, and they make sure that they're having a good time, and that everybody's having a good time, and how that changes your experience. And so what it really reminded me of is that when people walk into Revive Baptist Church, they need to know that we love their kids, don't they? They need to know that we care and that we're happy about those little kids coming to our church. Not that we look at them as a burden, not that we roll our eyes. And part of that is by having plenty of nursery workers and workers for the kids. You know, I don't know if you guys know this, but I think Lacey has taught kids' church since the church began. Since the church began, she has been almost the only one that has taught kids' church. I think she's had a couple breaks. And then in nursery, and I met with Luke and Kayla yesterday, and I met with Kayla, and we discussed some very exciting things for the nursery that I'm very excited about. We got this huge alligator thing coming. It's going to hang on the wall. It's huge. It takes up almost the whole wall, length of the wall. It's got all these little things and doohickeys that kids can play with and all those things, and I'm so excited. And because one thing is I was like, we need to make sure that when people show up and go to our nursery, they know that we care about their little kids being there and that we're happy to see them. And I was talking with Kayla, and I was discussing how many nursery workers we had. And I was kind of shocked. I was kind of shocked at how few nursery workers we had. And so I want you to pray and think about getting involved in the nursery. We need about four families or eight people to get involved. And what that will allow is you will be in the nursery once every 2 months. Once every 2 months. And that is extremely doable. That is very easy for anybody to do. Right now, I think it is pretty easy for nursery. It's about once a month is about what it should require if we go through the rotation. Now, I understand if somebody can't be there, things like that. If you don't have kids in the nursery, I want to encourage you to think about working in the nursery because, one, that is our future. That is our future of where Revive Baptist Church is. You know, I thought about watching little Noah and Carson running around, and I'm like, one day I'm going to sit in Revive Baptist Church, and I'm going to be too old and feeble-minded to preach, and they're going to be the ones running the church. And they're going to be the ones that are singing, and they're going to be the ones teaching Sunday school, and they're going to be the ones leading our church, and it's important that we let them know that we love them and we care about them. Amen? Amen. So I really want you to give that some thought and prayer. You know, it's just like Brother Kent talked about excuses. Everybody has one, right? But I want you to think about that. Committing to once every 2 months, I think that is very doable for almost every person in here to commit to the nursery to every 2 months and then consider working in with the kids during the 11 o'clock hour and teaching those kids and investing in them. Trust me, I know and understand what it's like to be in a kid's class teaching kids when you want to be out in the main service. But as we do that, as we serve, we show that we love one another. Amen? And so if you want to show people that you love them and you care about them, somewhere in this church, in Revive Baptist Church, you should be serving in some capacity. Amen? There should be something you do, because trust me, you come in on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock and warming up a chair is not what we need you to do. Amen? Those chairs will be just fine without you sitting in them. We need to be serving, loving one another, and caring. And so while I was in nursery, I did greatly enjoy it. I had a lot of fun with the kids and playing with them, but that was definitely something that I believe the Lord laid on my heart, is that when people walk into our church, they feel welcome when they have kids of whatever age and know that we are excited to see them and that we are excited to teach those kids and invest in them. You know, little kids don't need just game time and running around time. They need time where they need people to care and teach them things, care about them and teach them things about the Bible. Because every day, they're going, or 5 days a week, they're going to go to school and they're going to hear that they come from monkeys and that there is no God. And they're going to hear all these different things that they're being taught. And we need to be on the other side going, you know what? There is a God that loves you and cares about you. And teaching them basic stories of the Bible and beginning to build upon that foundation so that they can be the strong Christians that I can tell you, as the world is continuing to go, we are going to need very strong Christians. Amen? We are going to need young people to be very grounded in their faith and to know what they believe and why they believe it. Now, another reason that I worked in the nursery is that I feel that it's very, very important. And I tell you, I try to know every single kid's name in here. And I try to talk to them and interact with them. Now, some of your kids make me work very hard to be able to get to hold them or get a high five or whatever, and that's okay. It made me work very hard. But one reason I do that is because one of the number one reason why kids leave a church after they graduate high school is the church they went to is their parents' church. It's one of the number one reasons. So if you ever see me trying to talk to your kid, that's because I want your kid to know this is their church and I want to be their pastor. I don't want them to just view this as I only went to Revive Baptist Church because that was my parents' church. I want them to know that I'm a pastor that loves and cares about them too. All right. That was enjoyable, right? Remember, Pastor Kent said, when the pastor has to get on to you about things, don't get mad at the pastor. Amen? Amen. That's right. Just doing my job. But I am grateful for everyone that serves in our church. Grateful for Luke. We were here all day yesterday setting up the sound system, getting those things ready. I am very thankful for all the food. I thought it was absolutely, every meal was phenomenal. Every meal was so good. We had so much food, desserts. It was just very overwhelming. I was very appreciative. So last month, we talked about getting back to the basics. Getting back to the basics of the gospel and God's word. And now this month, we're going to start a series called Next Steps. Next Steps. One of the reasons that we as a church challenge ourselves every quarter is because as a believer, you should be able to look back and know that you have grown spiritually more than you did the previous year. Amen? So why do we do a prayer challenge? So we do a 90-day prayer challenge the first quarter of the year, January, February, and March. You pray for somebody, you send them a text message, hey, you are on my heart today, and I prayed for you, and you let them know. You keep track of how many you do, and then you turn it into Tim, and you let him know. Our goal is 1,101. Do you know why we do all the ones? Because every time you think of someone, they are that one that needs you to pray for them and care enough about them. I can tell you, over the few months, I've received messages from people. Hey, I was praying for you today. And do you know what? It meant a lot to me. It's an encouragement to people to let them know that you're praying for them. And so that's why we do these challenges, so that every year we look back and see that we are progressing forward. We are maturing as believers. Do you know that? Actually, you know where I get that from? The way that we need to mature, you know where I get that from? It comes from the Bible. Isn't that interesting? New Christians, it talks about, they will drink the milk, right? Now, I don't know about you, but I'm pretty sure at some point in your life, you said, I don't want to drink milk anymore. I want food, right? You ever see a baby the first time they get something real sweet and sugary? That is all they want, isn't it? They are like, that is good. And that's all they want. But you know what? We also need the meat and potatoes. And if you study the Bible, it'll actually call itself the milk, honey, food, water, meat, potatoes. How many of you are a steak and potatoes kind of person? Amen. That's normal people right there. Normal people. Normal. And so we need to be moving forward as a church. I've seen many people, being in ministry, I've been in ministry, I think, quite a long time now, and one thing that I can tell you is that I've seen people get saved, get into church, and never really mature as believers. They don't really mature. They just start kind of fizzling out. They might show up on Sundays, but they're not real faithful to their Bible reading. They're not really faithful to their prayer time. They don't really get into the Word. They're not really serving in church anywhere. They're just kind of there. You know, if I was to tell them to turn to the book of Eleazar or something like that, they might open their Bible and try to find it, even though it's not there. And so as believers, it is important that we progress and become more mature. Now, one of the goals of our church is that we would grow in number. Now, I've heard many people say that it is not good that a church focus on growing in number. Now, I'm going to explain to you why that's wrong and why biblically it is a biblical thing. And I'll explain that to you. So not just so that we can feel better about ourselves, but Jesus commanded us to grow. The last thing Jesus said to his closest followers before he ascended back into heaven was, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, and teaching them to observe whatsoever I have commanded you. And surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age. What is that called? It's called the Great Commission. And what did Jesus say right there? He said, go, make disciples of all nations and baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. So we are to go and reach people with the gospel. Amen? We are to go out and deliver the message of the good news. But if it's just about moving people from unchurched to church, there's a whole lot of easier ways to do that. If our goal was just to get people to sit in these chairs on Sunday, there's some pretty easy ways to do that, isn't there? Right? I saw one church, I was amazed, and it was in Eastgate, Ohio. They were having a Super Bowl party, and guess what they were giving away? No. Oh, no. Nope. Way worse than that. You're not even close. Beer. Beer. Come to the Super Bowl party. Let's all get together, get drunk, and worship the Lord. Amen? In the spirit. It amazes me that people can have that ideology. But we could throw out a bunch of beer and say, hey, we're all going to get drunk. Let's come to Revive Baptist Church. We could do major guilt trips. You know, we could go up to people and just guilt them and just constantly guilt them, and eventually they might show up. Or one of my favorites, we could just do a mass kidnapping. We could get the church van and just go out and grab people, throw them in, bring them to church. Or some of you would like this. We could go to Paul Brown Stadium and say, we're going to have church at 1 p.m. while the football game's going on. And we could say, we had a lot of people in church today, right? So we all know that something has to happen, though, if the connection is going to really last. God has to get a hold of our hearts, or we have to allow God to get a hold of our hearts. We could maybe get record numbers of people at church in a weekend, but they wouldn't be there the next week unless we did something equally spectacular. As great as that would be, it would be depressing the week after, right? Seeing nobody there. The hard truth is that people fall away, and how many of you know someone who was once with God, walking close to God, and then now they're not? So there are big fallaways, like when someone makes a very intentional decision not to follow God anymore. You got to know when you got to come back. Jesus isn't looking down at from heaven and shaking his head and thinking, well, you know, it's about time. Glad you didn't wait till it's too late. As we saw, the Bible says that all of heaven and the angels rejoice over one sinner that comes to repentance. Brother Kent talked about that. It's one of my favorite verses because it reminds me that when I first accepted Jesus Christ, when I first gave my life to Jesus, all of heaven and the angels were rejoicing over me getting saved. Amen? Just like it was for you. Just like it was for you when you made that decision to follow Jesus Christ. Just like when Mackenzie came down Wednesday night and gave her life to Christ, all of heaven and the angels were rejoicing. We, as Revived Baptist Church, got to take part in something that caused all of heaven and the angels to rejoice. And I like that. Amen? I think 2022 needs to be the year that we focus on giving heaven a whole lot to rejoice about. Amen? Spiritual growth isn't so much like taking step after step towards God. It's often many people take two steps forward, one step back, two steps forward, three steps back. You get the idea. That's why we have to give grace to people. Give grace. But ask yourself the question, am I moving forward spiritually or am I stagnant or are you even moving backwards? Maybe you've had feelings that God is disappointed in you. You did that again. You're still struggling with that. I thought we were past this. Here's a cool thing that we see over and over in the life of Jesus. Jesus was always calling people to a higher standard. But Jesus, when he called people to a higher standard, Jesus was a great encourager. You could actually say he was the ultimate encourager. He was always cheering people on. Get back up. Let's try again. I believe in you. That's why people were constantly flocking to Jesus. Those who felt the least worthy and the most rejected flocked to Jesus because they were accepted by Jesus. It's really encouraging to know that some of the folks that we hear about in the Bible face the same things as we do. We're going to look at a passage in Hebrews where it sounds like the whole church had faded away, and God looks at his individuals or looks at us as individuals, but also as a church. I've always said it's important to remember, sin outside the doors of the church will never cause our church to close, but sin inside the church will. The spiritual temperature of a church is important to God. Where Revived Baptist Church is, where we are spiritually. We as a church will reproduce not just what we say, but what we do. Your spiritual maturity is extremely important because it impacts other people. Not just your family, not just your spouse, not just your kids, but all of those around you. Have you ever thought that as you are faithful to church and you're here consistently every Sunday, that is an encouragement to other people? And then as you're not here and you go through maybe once a month or twice a month, you show up, that it's a discouragement on those times that you're not here because people miss you and recognize it. But it is important where we are spiritually, which leads into many times of who we spend time with. Who we spend our time with is going to dictate kind of who we become because of the influences around us. I heard a lady one time say she was thinking about being a detective. I thought that was very odd. She had no training that I knew of or had anything to ever do with being a detective. Come to find out, she was watching a lot of CSI. Okay? You ever watch a movie and then you go, I think I could do that. You know what I mean? You're like, I think I could do that. You know? You watch a movie where some guy's like busting down doors and taking out bad guys and you're like, I could do that. I could do that. Men are the worst. Men are the worst. I know many men, and I'm going to tell you a little secret for the ladies, and maybe you do it too, I don't know, but men are really bad. We visualize things. We visualize walking into our house and there being robbers, and we think about how we'd grab the first guy, punch him in the throat, drop him by the knee, go to the next guy, pull our gun, take out three guys. We visualize things. I'm telling you, it's true. No man can deny it. You know, we walk past this giant dog and we're like, I wish you would come over that fence, buddy. I'd grab you by the throat and teach you a lesson. That's how men think. That's how we visualize things. You know, we watch movies with Arnold Schwarzenegger and all that and we're like, I could do that. I could do that. I could take a motorcycle and jump off a building and land on a helicopter or whatever, or an airplane. I guess you wouldn't want to land on a helicopter. Land on an airplane, and I'd be just fine. I could do that. I could do that. But it's because of those influences. Those things influence us. I've said this many times. I have a friend. He always said, if you sit in a barber shop long enough, you're going to get a haircut. You sit around people getting drunk long enough, it's only a matter of time till you're going to get drunk and get wasted with them. It's only a matter of time. Only a matter of time. You hang out with people that don't value marriage and faithfulness in marriage, it's only a matter of time. What if we as a church doubled and all the new people had the same passion for moving forward in spiritual maturity as you do? I want to challenge, I want you to think about that this morning. If our church, all of a sudden, let's just say, 50 people walked into Revived Baptist Church and wanted to join. And they had the same spiritual desire and faithfulness that you do. What would that do to Revived Baptist Church? Would we begin to have more people volunteering in nursery and taking care of kids and cleaning the church and working in sound and working in the slides and working on the live stream or teaching Sunday school classes? Would they come in like that? Would they have a heart of service? Would they come in and if all 50 people came in and were just like you, would they have a spiritual knowledge, biblical knowledge? Would they have a desire to get into a discipleship program? Would they have a desire to get baptized? Would they have a desire to reach more people for Jesus? Would we see a growth in service? Or would we have 50 people that would just come in and warm up a chair? If 50 people showed up at our church next Sunday and had the exact same spiritual desire as you do, how would that affect our church? Would that be a good thing or would that be a bad thing? Would that actually be a negative? If everyone who came to the church was faithful as you are, in attending church on Sundays, how would that affect our church? If 50 people came in and were just as faithful to attending as you were, what would that do to our church? Look at Hebrews chapter 5, I know that was a very long intro. Chapter 5, verse 11, Hebrews. It says, of whom we have many things to say and hard to be uttered, seeing you are dull of hearing. I like that. Dull of hearing. If you have teenagers, you know what it's like to have someone be dull of hearing. For when, for the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God. Talking about the first, the basics. And are become such as have need milk and not of strong meat. So they started out growing. They were going to get off the milk. They were going to start growing closer to God and growing spiritually to where they could have strong meat, but they've went back to the milk. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. And we don't mean it in a good way. I hear that a lot. Lacey says I'm a babe a lot. I don't know why you're laughing. Verse 14, but strong meat belongeth to them that are full of age, and even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Now, a lot of times we read Scripture, if you don't really get into the context of it, you might think right there that he's talking about only older people in physical age. Physical age being able to discern both good and evil. But as you can see here, he's talking about the spiritual age. He says some had grown in spiritual age to where they should have been able to eat the meat, but they stuck to the milk. And so when he's talking about the age, he's talking about the spiritual age. Hebrews 6 chapter 6, verses 1 through 3. It says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of the doctrine of baptism and the laying on hands and resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permit. Now, what's going on here? What does that even mean, what I just said? The people are no longer trying to understand. Remember, these are Christians he's dealing with. He's not saying they had given up on God. He's not saying that they have given up on moving forward necessarily completely. Do you know you can be a Christian and give up growing spiritually? It's possible to be at a church every week and no longer try to grow closer to Jesus. The people still needed the spiritually elementary truths. Even though they had many mature believers among them, they still needed milk. They were still not ready for the solid food. I'm grateful today that I do not have to drink milk, right? That'd be an awkward phone call to my mom, right? The author of Hebrews is saying, you should be off the bottle by now and on to steak and better things. You need to grow spiritually. Every time someone offends you in the slightest way, you get hurt and you take it so personal, is one thing they were dealing with. Anytime a challenge to you, you get out of your comfort zone, you just want to totally ignore it. I've heard many people say, I could never teach kids, I'm not patient enough. I couldn't teach. Every Sunday, and you will grow faster as a believer because you will have to study more in depth what you're teaching. Amen. Thank you. I got Anita with me this morning. Thank you. You will learn more. That's not in my comfort zone. I could never. Do you know what our church would be like if I said that all the time? Do you know what it would be like? Do you know that as a pastor, I never went to school to learn how to hook up sound equipment, but I had to before we had the amazing Luke Ferdette. I had to hook up sound equipment. Do you know that I never went to school to learn how to run a projector and how to hook those things up and calibrate them and put screens up, but I had to? Do you know I never went to school to learn how to lay a floor down, but I had to? I'm sure you know that I didn't went to school if you look close enough. Do you know I never went to school to learn how to use paint sprayers? But the Huntington Bank, before we had the amazing Gary Likens, who could do it for us, and it looked a lot better. But I had to. Do you know there were times where I had to do things that were greatly out of my comfort zone? One thing, when I was worked at Buckeye, I used to be the manager of the quick lane on the maintenance side. Do you want to know something that used to drive me crazy? Is I would give a job to a technician, and you know what they would say? Well, I've never done that before. Well, you're about to learn here in just a minute. You're going to learn how to do that job. And they would get out of their comfort zone, and it would be something, and I would be there to help them if they had problems. And then there was another guy named Roger, and if I didn't know how to fix it, I'd say, well, go ask Roger. I don't know how to fix it, but he'll show you what to do. It is natural to get out of your comfort zone. There's a natural way that we will act if we are left to ourselves. If we are not intentional in growing in spiritual maturity, then over time you will drift from God. It's not that you purposely walk away from God. You just get complacent. You get apathetic to the point where, like the author of Hebrews says, you are not even acquainted with righteousness. You're not even acquainted with it. How did I get here? How did I drift so far from God? The author gives some answers, and I'll move quickly here. Understand that God wants you to grow in maturity. No. God wants you to grow in spiritual maturity. Know that. Understand that and accept that God wants you to grow in spiritual maturity. And then be intentional. Be intentional. How many of you have ever had something you're like, I need to do that. I need to get that done. I need to do that. I need to meet with that person. Do you know what I found is the easiest way to make sure you get something done? Write it down, put it on a calendar. I wanted to learn how to play the guitar, and I wanted to play with a young man, and I wanted him to sing because I can't sing, and I wanted to play the guitar. So do you know what I did? I put on the calendar, in 3 months, we are singing that song, and I told everybody we're going to sing that song. Do you know what that forced me to do? It forced me to practice because I knew at that time I was going to have to do that. So you, as a believer, are going to have to put on your spiritual calendar or your physical calendar that I'm going to read the book of Hebrews. I'm going to read the book of Philippians. I'm going to read the book of Colossians. And then you know what you might do? Hey, pastor, I need you to hold me accountable that in 1 month I'll have read this book, and I want you to ask me if I read this book. Do you know I have my brother-in-law who gives me good advice on different things? Do you know that sometimes I do that with him? I call him up. I say, hey, buddy, I feel like I'm falling behind in this area, and I want to improve it. I want you to call me every day and ask me if I'm doing that. I'm telling you, find somebody that don't ask a friend, because a friend will give you excuses of why it's okay that you didn't accomplish it. And my brother-in-law, when I call him up and I ask him about reading something or challenging me something, do you know that I would rather die than tell him, than not get something done, than have to tell him I did not accomplish it? And that's why I call him. Because I would be embarrassed, and ashamed if I do not accomplish what I have said to him that I need to accomplish. Hebrews 6:1, it says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and faith toward God. What does that mean? How many people here want to mature? We all want the end result. We want to be mature and maturing without doing what it takes to mature. I had a guy working for me one time. He said, I should be the boss around this place. I should be your top technician or foreman. That's what you call it. He said, I should be your foreman. And I said, well, why in the world would I do that? And he said, because I know what I'm doing and I do a good job. I said, well, you usually call off a day a week and you're usually late three times a week. I should fire you, not give you a promotion. But it always seemed like every 20-year-old would come into Buckeye in the maintenance area, and they would want to come in, and they would want to be the foreman, and I'd be like, well, you don't even know half the stuff of what you're doing, and you're not faithful to work, so why in the world would I make you the foreman? We want the end result without doing the work, and that's natural, and I understand that. One thing, another thing that'll help you is keeping your eyes on the prize, right? When I stand before God, as Paul said, I want to hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant. I was discipling Brandon Saturday, and which I'm excited. He's done, so he just finished. Very excited for him. He's going to get a big certificate here soon. 16-step discipleship. Every believer needs to have went through the 16-step discipleship so that you have a strong foundation. And in the last one, we begin discussing the five crowns. The five crowns that we'll receive when we get to heaven and we go to the judgment seat of Christ. And, you know, I do get a little competitive. You can ask some of my brother-in-laws. I definitely get competitive. But when I stand before Christ, and the Bible says that we'll receive these crowns, and I'm talking physical crowns, not like crowns you color with, crowns, beautiful crowns. And when we receive them, we're going to have something, and we're going to take them, and we're going to lay them at the feet of Jesus. And we're going to say, it was all because of you. I don't know about you, but I don't want us to be standing there watching everybody go up and lay crowns at the feet of Jesus and not have anything. I don't want to have just one or maybe even two. I want as many of those five crowns as I can get, and I want to take them off, and I want to lay them at the feet of Jesus and say thank you. Let me get to my next point. I'm going to move ahead here a little bit. Training is required for any significant challenge in your life, just like growing spiritually. Nobody shows up at the Olympics, like for the bobsled team that's never been on a bobsled, and then goes, I'm going to compete in the Olympics in the bobsled team, because it's not going to end well, is it? 1 Corinthians 9:25, it says, and every man that striveth for the mastery of temperate in all things, now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we do it to obtain an incorruptible. The incorruptible crown. 1 Timothy 4:7, but refuse profane and old wives' fables, and exercise thyself rather unto godliness. This is my life verse. For bodily exercise profiteth little. Are you guys with me here? That's hilarious, okay? I can see most of you are going to go home and you're going to Instagram and Facebook, hashtag my life verse. Bodily exercise profiteth little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of the life that now is and that which is to come. 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. That verse right there, everyone should know right where that verse is and have it memorized. Training methods are used to grow spiritually. There was a guy named Ken Dady. He introduced me something that I thought was very cool. He gets a little index box of cards, and he labels them a few different ways. He writes down a verse, and then he puts it in the everyday category. And every day he gets that card out and he reads that verse. And then he has a once a week category. And then once he feels like he's read that card enough every day, it moves to the once a week category. And then only once a week does he get that card out and read it again. And then he moves it to the once a month and the once a year. And he has all these index cards to help memorize verses. You see, I would love to be able to have the scriptural memorization of Ken Dady. I would love to just be able to throw every verse out just like that, no problems. But what do I have to do to obtain that? Practice. I have to, first of all, decide to do it. Second of all, come up with a method. And thirdly, do it. A disciplined person is someone who exercises a lot of discipline. A disciplined person is someone who can do the right thing at the right time in the right way with the right spirit. Think about Steph Curry. Makes a lot of money playing basketball. They said he shoots 200 three-pointers a day in practice. And he only makes 40% of his three-pointers in a game, which actually that's a very high percentage. But he shoots 200 three-pointers a day. It's just like young people wanting to be professional athletes, but not shooting 200 three-pointers a day. It always amazes me. I'll see families put sports so high on their list, and I'm like, if your kid can't outrun me at 35 and overweight me, they're probably not going to be a professional athlete. If you want to be a professional, you better train like one. Decide that you're going to train. Get at a workout plan spiritually. Move forward and progress. Hebrews 12:1 says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us." Run the race. "Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. And consider him that endured such a contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you be wearied and faint in your minds." Anytime you get tired, and you feel like, "I just don't feel like reading my Bible today. Today, we got to set our clocks an hour forward, and I lost an hour of sleep. Pastor, I can't read my Bible at night. I'm too tired." Anytime that you feel wearied, think about what Christ endured. Our ultimate inspiration has to be Jesus. It has to start with him. It's not about moving toward an arbitrary line. It's about moving toward Christ in a spiritual maturity. If you would go ahead and stand with me this morning. I think some of you during the revival grew spiritually. One reason I can say that is I think Brother Kent York probably would have said things that would have offended many people. Because he cracked the whip. He kind of got on to people spiritually. And you endured it. And hopefully you made a decision to mature from it. I would encourage you today, I'd like for you to come forward and pray and ask God how you can serve at Revive Baptist Church. How you can serve at Revive Baptist Church. How God wants to use you to move Revive Baptist Church forward. I'll say a short prayer, and as the music plays, and when I say amen, you take that first step and just allow God to speak to you on what he would have you to do. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for everything that you have done for us. God, I ask that you bless this time of invitation and that you would speak to our hearts and minds. We praise you and love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. been great to be in the Lord's house. Amen. You know, I heard someone say one time that they thought Christianity was you got saved and it was like you got handed a new pair of ice skates and you got to go to a skating rink and nobody was there and it was just you and you just floated around the ice rink and you and the Lord and it was so peaceful and calm. And he said, being a Christian's not like that at all. You get handed a pair of ice skates and pads and you're on a hockey team and you're going for the NHL Cup and you better be tough and ready to go. You know? But the Bible says that if you're going to run, run that you may obtain. And we're running. We're believers in Christ. We're running. And I want to obtain many of those crowns as I can. Amen? Amen. And I hope that that's your heart's desire. It's important that as a church that we do grow in number, but spiritual maturity is the most important. But through that spiritual maturity, you know what that produces? That will cause us to reach out and get the gospel out. And that will cause us to grow in number. And but I tell you, I'm very excited how God has worked. I don't know if you know this, but we've beat every attendance record we had last year so far this year. So we've had more people in church on a Sunday every single Sunday than what we had last year. And that's a good thing. Amen? Amen. Well, let's pray. We'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we love you today. We just thank you for everything that you've done for us. God, I would just ask that you would be with us today. Help us to stay encouraged and help us to run that we may obtain. Help us to make a plan to get things ready, to ask for accountability partners and helping us move forward. And bless us as we go this week. In Jesus' name, amen.